Hey, what's up? Welcome to Movie Dumpster Season 5, Episode 2. Today we're talking about My Demon Lover from 1987, directed by Charlie Loventhal. I'm Joel Escola.
And I'm Sean O'Rourke.
Welcome to the dumpster. Can you feel it? Can you feel the love that's in the air?
It's like, what's the term? Static electricity.
Oh, yeah.
Crackling.
It's all tingly and shit.
Yeah, it's like the leaves when the weather gets cold. You go outside, what's that sound? It's like that. It's that crackly sound, but it's love.
Yeah, well, it's the...
Your heart grows five times, Joe.
Like the fucking Grinch?
Yeah. Why
it's
not?
That, it's like a warm summer breeze that envelopes you, right? Caresses your body.
All wrapped in a, Russell Stover's box of chocolates.
There you go. Yeah. And with a fucking red bow on it.
Yeah. You know, life, Joe. Some people say, not everybody, but some people do say it's like a box of chocolates. I've heard that.
You never know if you're going to be turned into a fucking pozassed or what, you know? Maybe.
That is a really good point.
You might get zapped right in the fucking dick by grandma.
Or right above it, right where the belly button would usually be. Possibly.
Granny Van Damme takes no prisoners, by the way.
Yeah.
So here we are, again, the second episode of season five. Here we are on video once again. I'm still kind of freaked out about it. It's a little strange for me. And sometimes I don't know what to do with myself when I'm waiting to respond.
Yeah, you got the hands flailing. You know, you do one of these. You know, you're not really sure what to do.
You do one of these.
You know, just really go all in on it, you know?
One of those, yeah. Yeah. So yeah, we're talking about My Demon Lover from 1987 today.
A movie I had, you know, we do a lot of movies on this show that I haven't heard of. The last one I had. This definitely is in the category of movies I had not heard of until you were like, hey, this is perfect for our Valentine's Day episode this year.
This is one of those times where I'm going to be like, hey, I brought this up on the show. And you're going to be like, I don't remember you doing that, but I totally did. Maybe if somebody knows, they can comment. I don't remember, but I totally talked about this. And I don't remember what I had said about it, but here we are. And it's a very nice segue into the holiday.
Yeah.
Capitalizing on the holiday, rather, with this and the Valentine book to the movie, but
yeah.
But this is a movie to behold, right?
Yes,
it is probably one of the better horror comedies of the 80s, in my opinion.
It definitely leans harder on the comedy for sure, but yeah. I would agree.
Yeah, I mean, but.
There's absolutely horror elements. Don't get me wrong.
It's a horror comedy, but yes, to the forefront. It's a, as some people would say, it's a comedy first. Anyway,
not you, Tony. By the way, Tony from Act the Movies, just sit back down. Ghostbusters Afterlife was good.
It's fine. Anyway, yeah. So this is directed by Charlie Loventhal, and the only other credit that's even notable is Mr. Wright. It's a movie called Mr. Right. I believe it's from 94, and it's with Paul Reiser, isn't it? Paul Reiser.
Okay.
The dude from Aliens. You know
him. Yeah, Paul Reiser, of course. Okay. No, I know who you're talking about. Yeah. Kind of weirdly funny to me, though, that his last name starts with the word love.
We got fucking Loventhal. We got Valentine. My Demon Lover. There's fucking red balloons and heart balloons. Yeah. I like the motif. And even... the asshole that I am, my tape is upstairs. But the tape, the tape is upstairs, and we're not stopping the recording to go grab it. But we're showing it on screen right now. It's got like a pink case to it, and it's got the red motif. I mean, it's My Demon Lover, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah,
red hot, passionate, sexy pink Valentine's Day. Scott Valentine looking handsome in his fucking Huey Lewis in the News jacket.
I would say hot red, like, a cherub's pecker, possibly.
Oh, yeah, right in your old mouth there.
Well, that's my... Again, I did that a little earlier on the video version. If you're watching, you know, you saw what I did.
You sucked the cherub's dick? When was I?
I did that little hand motion. Oh, yeah. You know, just pretend there was a cherub's, you know...
That was a monster hog, though, you were grabbing.
I was a big tallywhacker on that cherub, man. He's got some serious wood on that boy.
Little man's packing, yeah.
Clearly. I felt it in the back of my throat, Joe. That's all I'm going to say.
Nothing says Valentine's Day like a gag on a dick.
Yeah, from a fucking cherub, from Cupid. Choke on this sword!
Yeah. When it shoots, does it shoot like those shitty, like, chalky candies down
your
throat?
Well, I gotta be honest, you know, let's just really just, you know, pull the string on this joke. You know, it's kind of like birthday cake ice cream, honestly.
Oh!
Specifically, the flavor, it's even, you know, I feel like I tasted some sprinkles, but I couldn't confirm because it was in the back of my throat.
It was like a funfetti right down the old windpipe.
Honestly, I'd do it again.
Yeah.
It was that good.
Like a feeding tube.
If yeah. I could regurgitate it, I would, but, you know, it was just for me.
You throw it up a little bit in your mouth so you can get the taste, then you swallow it again, right?
Stack for later.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect. Like that box of chocolates.
Exactly. Thank you for bringing it all the way back around. Yeah.
It's what I do. So, yeah, this movie's written by Leslie Ray, and she's written a ton of television. She is a white woman, but she's wrote for a lot of black television, which is kind of plays into what, you know, the motif of the last episode and stuff, too, for Black History Month and stuff. But she's written for Fresh Prince and Sister Sister, Steve Harvey Show, The Wayans Brothers Show.
Some bangers.
There was another show, I forget what it's called, but it has Red Fox in it, but it's not.
Oh, yeah, because there was a second show with him after Sanford and Son, but I forget what it was called.
Yeah,
also.
It wasn't Sanford and Son. It was something else, and I couldn't remember the name. But she's also written for, like, Dawson's Creek, Full House, shit like that.
Wow.
Which is kind of strange. So she has, like, you know,
chops.
She's got chops, or she's good at what she does. Mm-hmm. But the comedy in this movie is fucking on point. I don't think anything really falls flat. There's a couple, but not.
I mean, there's a couple things that we'll get into when we get into the review, and it's, you know, more so you know, of the times kind of jokes. But, like, yeah, 98% of the jokes are just, they work.
I was laughing more than I wasn't.
I would agree.
So I really want to talk about the special effects real quick.
Oh, the special effects! Oh my god! Just before you get into that,
yeah, go ahead.
This movie is one of the weirdest films I've ever seen, and the special effects are a key point, because you're like, when you're getting into this, you see the cover, you're like, okay, this is going to be some weird thing where she's going out with a guy that's a demon, but you don't know much else, and then you're watching the movie, and you're like, huh, okay, so that's where it's going. Oh, that's where it's going. Wait, really, that's where it's going? Oh, holy shit, that's where it's going?
Stop me if I'm wrong, but is it, when you walked into this, did you expect something similar to, like, I don't know, like Bedazzled or something with Brendan Fraser and, what's her face?
Not quite, but definitely more in line for sure with that.
Well, what I mean is, like, you didn't expect people to be transforming into crazy
No.
At least maybe one thing.
Maybe. It was like kind of a movie, and again, we're going to get into this, but like where things just kept escalating, but in a way where, like, I didn't feel like it didn't earn it. Like, every escalation was earned.
Okay.
And it was like, oh, every escalation was like more out of left field, and I'm just like, okay, movie, this is I'm into it, but holy cow, like, what are you taking on?
Yeah. And I'm not usually,
and those effects, just to bring it back to what you're saying, are a major part of that. I mean, the writing, obviously, is key, too, but that the effects, oh my god.
It's just like it comes out of left field, right? Because at the forefront, this is like a horror, at the forefront, it's a comedy.
Yeah, yeah.
Or a romantic comedy, really. Yeah. It's a fucking rom-com with monsters, which is kind of unique in and of itself.
Yeah.
Right? But yeah, you wouldn't expect these kind of effects to pop up here, and so many of them, and done so well.
Practical, digital.
There's practical, there's compositing. There might even be a little bit of stop motion. There's definitely miniature shit work going on. Practical makeup effects and animatronics and all kinds of shit. Transformations and out the ass, too.
That's what I'm saying, man. Yeah. Like, I had no clue what I was getting into, and I was pleasantly surprised. Yeah.
So we got John Dodds working on this, and if you guys don't know who John Dodds is, he did Deadly Spawn and Night Beast, and he worked on the Monsters television show. I mean, the guy's done a ton of stuff. He's prolific. He's one of my favorites. Going back to as far as, like, independent special effects people go. But, you know, if you want to know more about that, because we go, again, just like the Blackula episode, we go way into John Dodds on our Deadly Spawn episode, which was season 4, episode 5. So go check that out if you want to get a deep dive of John Dodds. And also, we did an interview with Ted Bowis, the producer, and not the writer, but he came up with the movie conceptually, and produced it. So it's his movie, more or less. But anyway, go check that out. It's very cool. And then we just have like a bunch of other, there's so many people that work. The team on this that they put together was fucking insane. And where they went from, not only in their past works, but going forward is incredible. I mean, we're talking, a lot of these people went on, are working on like Marvel movies right now.
Oh, wow.
Like it's pretty insane. We got Richard Alonso, who also worked on Monsters. He worked on the Boneyard, which we covered, which we love that flick. I love that.
Sure.
It's great.
It gave us Allie Oates, who hasn't been mentioned in a hot minute on the show, but for anyone that cares, she's the landlord to the MDU Wizards, and maybe we'll expand on that later.
Oh, yeah. He did Doom, which we did a commentary track for. You're going to get shameless shills because, again, we're trying to reach a whole new audience. And if people don't know about the shit, we got to tell you about it again.
And that Doom commentary is available over on patreon.com/moviedumpster.
$5 or $10 tiers. So he also works on Species.
Wow.
Yeah, under Steve Johnson and, of course, H.R. Giger. And again, he's like, he does Iron Man, Deadpool 2. He did The Jitters, a John Fansano movie that's not rock and roll orientated that we totally need to cover. But before we do that, I want to do Rock and Roll Nightmare or Black Roses, one of those. Both.
I mean, sign me up.
Yeah.
You know me. I pretty much am open to just about anything. If you're saying it's good, it's got to be at least worth watching.
Oh, it's a fucking time. You got John Michael Thor in Rock and Roll Nightmare.
I have no idea who that is, but I will find out, I'm sure, at some point.
Look him up. He's also a musician, so okay. You'll get a kick out of that. John Cagliano, or John Caglione Jr., or Caglione?
You're the Italian guy.
John Caglione Jr. There you go.
There you go. It sure as hell ain't John Pantoliano that I can... Why, maybe I actually said it right that time.
Pantoliano.
Joey Pants.
Joey Pants. Yeah, but he's like worked on Friday 3, Basket Case, Amityville 3D, Chud, Manhunter, the Blob remake. A lot of these people are working the same shows. The Boneyard comes up multiple times. Chud comes up multiple times. Ghostbusters 1 and 2 come up multiple times through here. Andy Clement, he'd worked on The Guyver, Ernest Scared Stupid, Army of Darkness, Zombie Nightmare, Basket Case 2, Frankenhooker. The list is just, like, we have an all-star effects team here. Mark Shostrom, who did Nightmare 3 and Evil Dead 2, Phantasm 2. He also worked on Monsters, Deep Star 6, Buffy. Michael R. Thomas, who did Ghostbusters 1 and 2, and Wolfen, and that's all I'm going to mention because those are the key ones that stood out for me, like as somebody who likes effects,
sure,
or knows the people in the biz, and like I like their work. But there's a ton of super talented people that have worked on this movie, and the team is just incredible. Like I was like taken aback by it, put it that way.
You telling me, I'm like sitting here like mouth agape for most of that,
and that's kind of it. You know, behind the BTS, if you will.
Hmm.
Yeah, not too much on it.
Not too much, but some incredible behind the scenes stuff, even if it's that a little bit there. Yeah.
Yeah. And like I said, the director didn't do much else of note. And the writer, you know, went on to do some good TV shows. But the effects people went on to do like amazing shows. You know what I mean? The way that this works out is incredible, because this shouldn't work as a movie.
That's
right?
What I'm saying.
It shouldn't work, and it shouldn't be this much fun. Like I like bad. We like bad movies.
Well, yeah,
and we like movies that are trying to be good but are also bad.
Right, that are underappreciated for reasons.
This is a hidden gem, I think, for a lot of you watching now. But there's probably a shit ton of you that are in this kind of circle of these movies that have at least heard of this movie before, if you haven't seen it. I know that's not available. I think it's streaming on Amazon.
Yeah, I think for rental, it might have been like $3 or $4.
Yeah.
Is there a DVD for this?
There is a DVD. I think it's out of print.
Hate when that happens.
Yeah, I have the tape, which is not here. It's upstairs. I mean, it's here. It's just upstairs. I'm not going to get it.
We got to send that cherub up there to get it.
Well, just extend his fucking dick upstairs. He'll climb the fucking stairs. Yeah. So, yeah. With that being said, do you want to plot crunch this one or you want me to do it?
Let's mix it up, at least in these first few. I mean, I don't think we'll be, ping-ponging back and forth on these plot crunches, but for these first couple, what the hell, man?
It's the first two episodes of the new season. Yeah. Let's fucking get into it. So Scott Valentine plays Kaz, who sounds like a fucking demon, right?
Yeah.
But that's just his, like, regular name as a dude. Anyway, he has a curse put on him to where whenever he gets horny, he turns into a demon.
He gets literal horns.
He literally, when he gets aroused, he literally grows horn. And, well, he looks like a fucking disgusting thing we'll get to. But yeah, so Scott Valentine, that's his deal. And then there's this chick, Denny, played by Michele Little, who's kind of like a doormat, if you will.
Oh, yeah.
And she's got really, really bad taste in men. Anyway, these two people meet. And it's one of those I can fix you can fix me kind of deals.
Yeah,
which actually ends up working out for them
somehow,
question mark. But yeah,
that's pretty the plot crunch.
Oh, and there's a mangler, there's somebody killing young women on the loose
that may or may not be Kaz,
but they're running around New York City.
Yeah, in the 80s. This movie is aggressively 80s, by the way.
Oh, I fucking love it, dude, because right when we kick it up, right with, what is it? What's the band's name? Intimate Strangers.
Yes.
I thought this was like a bigger band, but like, I think they wrote this specifically for this movie?
I mean, I could see where you're coming from that, because I kind of was thinking the same thing, because it's very polished.
Well, you just kick up that fucking Intimate Strangers and you let go, man, because we're going fucking face first into this flick. And you get like this little like devil animation.
Oh, yeah.
This is a New Line Pictures joint, by the way.
Yes.
Which I thought was a little strange that they had picked this up and distributed it or even produced it.
Stranger things have happened, Joe. But yeah, you get introduced to Denny.
Yeah.
As you see her kind of walking down the street with her groceries. And she kind of just, you get the feeling right away that she's a bit of a ditz. She goes down to like pet a stray dog and it just grabs her like baked good out of her hand and just runs away with it. And she's just like, oh, okay.
Even the pets are walking. Even the fucking animals walk over this woman.
Yeah, they make a joke later about her dog. Oh, yeah, your dog left you too?
Yeah. She's just a doormat that feels bad for
everybody.
Every puppy dog-eyed thing and gets taken advantage of all the time.
In fact, her boyfriend is literally her long-term relationship of 2 months is robbing her apartment.
She's really dedicated, man. It was a dedicated relationship.
This movie's comedy is just tacked perfect.
Oh, tacked sharp, dude. Yeah.
Yeah, because he's literally, you know, packing all her crap in the back of a van. She's like, is that TV?
She pulls up Chip, this guy. And these dudes are totally like looting her apartment and packing all her shit up. She's like, oh, that's my TV. That's my couch. That's my thing. That's my GE clock radio.
Yeah.
And he's like, smoke you, and just fucking gets in the back of the van and just drives away.
Pretty much.
And she fucking runs after them.
What is she gonna do? Like, get robot legs and catch up?
I don't know. I think it's a goof, like, where she's like,
this is the end of the relationship, blah blah blah,
which is kind of funny. But what happens later is kind of, we'll get to it.
Yeah. So then you're getting introduced to her friend Sonia.
Yeah.
Who is immediately like, you need to report this to the police, and she's like, I don't want to make a big deal out of it. Literally her TV and all her shit got stolen.
Gina Gallego.
She's really good in this. Yeah. I mean, honestly, all the principal characters I feel like are really good.
She's her comedy's on point too.
Yes.
She went on to do a bunch of other TV and stuff too. I don't have it in front of me, but
yeah, she's in a ton of stuff.
Again, you could probably just chalk it up to fucking SVU or Special Victims Unit or whatever. One of those fucking shows. Usually, one of these actors are always on those shows
or some form or version of Law and Order, because there's been so many at this point. Right. But she's kind of like this fiery Latina that she's friends with, who's just like not putting up with any shit. But you know, she's even busting Denny's balls, like, well, not her balls, but you know, she's busting her chop.
Yeah.
And you know, well, I guess we don't really know. But she's like, yeah, you gotta stand up for yourself. You gotta stop letting men walk all over you. She's like, I don't know how you get, you know, I don't know how you take care of men like the way you do. And it's like, yeah, she doesn't want people fucking walk all over her.
She doesn't take any shit from anybody. I love how, like, she's like, they took everything. They took my clock radio and my TV. All they left was this. And it's like a fucking can of sardines.
Yeah.
And then she's like, but he took a can opener. And, like, that's the kind of that a lot of the comedy is like that, but yeah. It's pretty funny. She goes, she's talking to Sony, and she's like, oh yeah, you know, all I wanted to do was have a birthday party, and they took all the stuff for the birthday. And she's like, they took everything, and all you want to do is throw a birthday party for him? And she's like, no, it's my birthday.
Yeah. Well, the whole joke is that she's saying that she wanted to throw a birthday party, and Chip was like, I don't think that's a good idea. Yeah. And it's like, it's for her own birthday. It's like, what? Okay. Clearly, she has some problems.
Big time.
Yeah.
So then we get introduced to Scott Valentine as Kaz.
This bum on the street this red blazer that's just covered in dirt, and his hair is just a matted mess.
He walks onto this fucking subway train, and again, he's just fucking sacked blowing. Huey Lewis in the news looking motherfucker. He's like, I'm Kaz from the planet Venus.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
This is my language, and starts playing the fucking saxophone.
I would love to know where he hides that saxophone. Is he sticking it up his ass? Is he just leaving it in a spot where no one's gonna bother it, and he picks it up when he needs it to make a few bucks?
I don't know, dude. Like, see, he's a bum, but he has checkbooks and credit cards of doctors that he's like lifted it from.
That was a great joke.
That was a really good joke.
He's like, you take check? No. What about credit card? He pulls out an American Express card.
And they're like, she's like, who's doctor whatever? And he's like, oh, don't worry about it. His fucking account isn't going to get overdrawn.
Yeah.
No big deal. He's a doctor.
But yeah, you're right, Joe. He's on the subway harassing people.
Not really. He's busking, but he's being a pain in the ass about it.
Well, he does go up to this one woman and starts hitting on her, and then you kind of don't know what happens.
Oh, yeah. This like, straight-laced woman's, like, reading, like, a fucking Clive Barker Books of Blood book. And again, like, you don't know it yet, but he's, like, looking at her lips and shit, and he's getting all, like, hot and bothered, and he ends up turning and, like, running off in the train somewhere.
Yeah, and I mean, again, this movie does a really good job of keeping information away from you to keep the tension, even
and
though
the
this
suspense.
Yeah, exactly. Where you assume it's him, but you don't really ever see it. Where you see this woman get off the platform, and she's holding a red balloon, which I don't know if that's symbolism to come back later, or if it's just kind of just playing up the whole Valentine thing.
Well, again, I don't think it's Valentine. Around. I mean, we're capitalizing on it, but it's the fact of, like, I think the red balloon has to do with, like, the victims of the mangler.
Okay.
In my opinion, that's the way it came across.
That makes sense. Because she has her face sliced open.
They're also MacGuffins, too.
Oh, yeah.
In a big way. So, some chick gets off the subway, and her fucking face is just totally mangled. And she's dead.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Ooh, yeah. She ain't coming back from that. She ain't no two-face.
No. She starts flipping a fucking coin. Comes with a red balloon. With yeah. Like fucking Pennywise, maybe?
Oh, my God.
Could be. So then we go to the New Age shop.
Yeah, and that's where Sonia works and her sister.
She owns it with her sister, I think. And they're deep into, like, the occult and magic and all kinds of stuff like that.
Yeah, they have, like, a rack of, like, weapons on the wall.
Enchanted weapons, by the way.
Yeah, they have, like, daggers and stuff with, like, demon names and stuff on them.
It's kind of cool.
Yeah, I like it. So then she gets a call at the store from this character that's got a thing for Sonya, but Sonya doesn't have a thing for her. This police chief character that I am going to just refer to as Kurtwood Smith for the rest of this episode, because this guy is the poor man's fucking Kurtwood Smith. And if you don't know who that is, if you've seen RoboCop, bitches leave.
Hey, Sonya.
Yeah, or Red from That 70s well, Show yeah. And a ton of other stuff he's been in. But that's every time this man was on screen, he looked like Kurtwood Smith with a fucking skin condition, because he's got, like, this kind of, like, tan to him.
Oh, yeah, he looks like Goldmember. Like, he's picking flakes off himself and fucking eating that shit.
Yeah.
I think his name's John Fudge in real life.
Oh, yeah. In the movie, he's Phil, but he's Kurtwood Smith on this episode.
Yeah, Phil Janis is his name in the movie.
And you kind of set up this idea that because she kind of, like, psychically knows he's going to call randomly. She's like, just tell him I'll bring him his umbrella tomorrow. And then he picks up the phone like, oh, yeah, she's not here. She'll bring you the umbrella tomorrow. She's like, how the hell did you know that? I don't know.
Because she knows this idiot in and out,
yeah,
I guess.
Well, yeah.
And, like, there's this whole thing. There's this thing about Denny where she's, like, this mousy chick, right?
Yes.
And Sonya's, like, this big-bosomed Latina.
Oh, yeah.
Like, don't take no shit from... beautiful woman. Oh, I mean, they're both beautiful.
Yeah, sure.
But, like, intimidating, if that makes sense.
Definitely playing into that stereotype a little bit, but like it works really well.
Yeah,
in the movie.
No, for sure. But I like that they're friends and they support each other.
Yep.
Anyway, so Scott Valentine, we cut to Scott Valentine like ski bopping down the fucking street, and he's like, now here's the thing I don't understand, because like if he gets horny, he'll turn into a fucking demon. Why is he trying to fuck all the skirt on this street?
I think he can't help it. He's just a horny guy.
Come here. And he's like grabbing people's asses and fucking like trying to kiss them and stuff.
I mean, here's the thing. We find out later that as a demon, he can climax. So it's not an issue of him not being able to, you know, crank his fucking hog.
I'm going to fucking...
You have some thoughts about that?
I have some thoughts about that, especially when we get to the apartment, the big apartment.
Because I wonder, like, as he start cranking it and then it just starts like getting spiked? You know, spiky dick like a cat or a duck or something. He's got
He's got the old corkscrew.
Yeah,
maybe?
I don't know. Does he kill his partner when he gets inside them? I don't.
Maybe it latches on, right? So they can't leave. They can't run away until he fucking shoots.
Yeah,
maybe. Let's ask the cherub.
Yep. Yeah.
Is that what happened? He fucking hooked into your mouth.
Listen, we're not getting into it. We've already given way too much detail into this cherub story.
Okay.
Again, like, if I need some funfetti, I'll give him a ring.
All right, there you go. Happy birthday, by the way.
Thanks.
You're welcome. just real quick, Leslie Ray is in this scene as the chick, because he's like, oh, yeah, you want to, like, you know, get together, like, or go on a date?
Yeah.
She like gives him like a fucking quarter because he's a bum.
Yeah, he's like, you want to go out for a cup of coffee? And she gives him a quarter. That's not what I meant.
So that night they go to this bar and
the local haunt.
Yeah, this is where Sonya's like, you're a fucking pushover and you date scum dog motherfuckers. And she's like, I just love everybody and like I can make any relationship work. It's okay to be a fucking dominated piece of trash and let people walk all over me because I'm good to people or something.
Yeah. While they're having that conversation, the wackiest character in this film is introduced, by the way.
Charles Lee Ray comes out.
This guy, Chuck. He looks like the guy from the Mac and versus Windows commercials.
He looks like...
Not Justin Long, obviously.
He looks like the dude from Honey, We Shrunk Ourselves.
Oh, my God.
The uncle, and I forget his fucking name. Help me out here.
It's the second Honey, I Blew Up the Fucking Kid movie, a sequel, so I really don't blame you for forgetting.
Here's a fucking deep cut that I only remember. He is the giant in Beanstalk.
Oh, God. Remember Beanstalk?
Yeah.
Beanstalk.
With the kid from the Full House episode that like used to get beat by his dad. He's like, I just think of Roger Rabbit and you know, it makes it not so awful. And Stephanie's like, what?
R.I.P. Bob Saget, I guess.
Well, yeah. Anyway.
But yeah, so this guy Charles comes over because he makes eye contact with Denny and, you know, he has this fucking drink with the parasol in it and like fruit and everything. And he's walking over and he's got this drink.
It's a fucking Mai Tai.
He's got, ooh, like dripping it all over women. And at one point, he's got a lighter trying to light a woman's cigarette and he can't get it lit. And he's like, looks like a clown.
That's a fucking great bit, too. By the way, it's Corpse Fuckers Mai Tai. Corpse Fuckers behind that bar. The MDU's coming fast and hard, so just keep
man.
Up here.
Do you even want to explain that real quick, Corpse Fucker?
You need to go... Okay, Corpse Fucker was born in the Pre-Hysteria 3 episode. So,
yes.
So go back and check that out. I think that was season 2?
Sounds right.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, Corpse Fucker is a character that... pretty much what he sounds like. He's essentially a Mad Max character that, I guess, protects a golf course, but he also plays cards with... Character, okay, let's back up a second. I don't want to get too deep into the woods. I just want to finish this thought.
Okay, go ahead.
He's one half of the MDU's, you know, protection group, the APA equivalent from the old WWF days.
Sometimes,
with his best friend.
His cohort.
And his cohort, yeah. And his poker buddy, honestly.
Kumdar, yeah.
The MDU's version of Goldar from the Power Rangers, who is made of... Come.
Yeah. I mean, he's not gold. He's white and pearlescent and all that beautiful stuff.
And, I mean, if you want to go back down the line and find out the illustrious history of this poker game, it's kind of been an ongoing joke for years where they have this poker game at the bottom of a well. It involves Leprechaun. We'll get back to it in March and expand on that maybe.
It's actually timely because the birth of Cumdar was our Valentine episode.
Okay, so maybe we'll be talking about that a little with the
circling it back, baby. You know how it goes.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's the quick assignment. We'll expand on that later with some more detail. But there's your minute explanation.
So this fucking guy Chuck is like bringing over Mai Tais and like spilling it all over himself and chick. And I love the cigarette thing because he's like trying to light the fucking cigarette and he like ends up like taking the cigarette out of the chick's mouth and like tries to light. I don't know. It's funny.
I remember my first cigarette. Yeah. It's like one of those kind of situations. Like you've never used a lighter before.
Well,
I mean, we all been there, but it's been a long ass time.
He should just fill it up or get a new one, as we find out later.
It's
anyway.
Just a damn blowtorch at that point.
So he's like, look at that fucking dork.
He walks over.
And he walks over and he's been trying to hit on Denny and like pick up Denny for like, I don't even, I mean, at this point, it must be like weeks or months.
At least.
Yeah. He's like, once we find out what's going on, he's like, or she's like his like prize woman or something.
But he's annoying as hell to the point where they're like, oh, hey, Charles. Oh, no, call me Chuck. Chucky.
Yeah, Chuck. Whatever's.
Yeah. His name's Robert Trevor, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah.
He just won't leave them alone, and he like
he fucking comes over and he's like, oh, bone swore, ladies, how you doing?
And Sonya's like, you're really gonna talk to this guy? He's got an umbrella in his drink.
He's got a paper parasol in his drink,
and he's got one in his fucking coat pocket. And he's like talking about his job, and he's like,
you think he collects them?
Oh, maybe.
Right, he puts them in his little fucking pocket protector, and then puts them at home in like a fucking fishbowl or something.
He just very well might. but yeah, he's talking about his job. And Denny's like, oh, I didn't know you were in education. He's like, no, I'm on the board of education. I do the discipline for the youngins. And then, like, to try to look tough, he, like, hits his hand on the table and these peanuts fly all over. And so he's like, all right, that's the end of that. Get the fuck out of here, Charles. Hit the road.
So he walks away, but he's still spilling his fucking drink all over people.
He spills it all over the woman he's trying to light the cigarette with.
Man. It's funny. It's fucking funny.
Yeah. It's, I had to watch it twice. It was hilarious.
But now...
Yes.
We get to Fixer.
Fixer, you got a problem? Shit, so what?
Fixer, yes.
Arnold Johnson.
This guy's pretty great in this minor role.
Yeah, and he's done a ton of black TV, too. He was on Family Matters, Sanford and Son, What's Happening. Yeah, so, and he's fucking great in this. So funny.
He's basically like a street, he's homeless, but he's like got his street cart where he's got kind of his... Press your luck, kind of fuck with people. Like, you know, spend your money, you might get something good, but you're probably never gonna really get something good, you know, kind of scam.
He's a snake oil salesman, but he's also in touch with the occult and the supernatural.
Yes.
Like he's not a phony, but he hustles people anyway to make money.
Exactly. Right? And he you get the impression that him and Scott Valentine know each other. From being on the streets, and Scott kind of goes up to him and tries to, you know, talk to him, but the guy's like, I sense something wrong about you, get the hell away with
me. He's like, you got the curse, boy, you an unlucky motherfucker, hit the bricks.
Yeah. And he's got all his stuff, like, in a suitcase, and he just closes it up and walks away, and Kaz is just like, what the hell?
He's like, oh, can you help me? And he's like, you got $20? Yeah. And he's like, no, and he's like, sorry, can't be helped.
Yeah, to help him with his situation that he doesn't elaborate on yet.
Well, no. But he knows. Fixer knows, you know? So we go to a police station, and, like, that character you were talking about before, Phil Janis, is lieutenant.
To get his umbrella. Sonya's gonna bring him the umbrella.
Sonya brings him the fucking umbrella.
This guy's a scumbag, by the way.
But as he's walking into his office, he's mobbed by the press. And they're like, oh, sir, can you comment on all the killings of the girls and blah, blah, blah? And he's like, listen, we're working on it, blah, blah, blah. And they're like, what are we going to do about this mangler, TM? And he's like, oh, for Christ's sake, we don't fucking call it the mangler. Now I'm going to have 20 fucking copycat manglers by the end of the night. Get out of here.
Joe Spinell saw that and was like,
it's maniac, not mangler.
I think that was happening around the same time.
And then Robert Englund was like, yes.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, then Sonya comes in, and there's like this creepy interaction that they have where he's like, hey, he's like, I'm good enough to sleep with, but I'm not good enough to date. And she's like, I didn't have a choice in that situation. I'm like, what is that? Was she drunk? Did he just rape her? Was he like what? There's a lot left on the table with whatever that implies.
If this guy tried to rape this woman, he'd be dead.
Well, this is true. She'd beat the shit out of him.
Also, maybe she was drunk and was like, oh yeah, that fucking skin funk man looks kind of hot.
Well, you know what it was? She actually thought it was Kurtwood Smith, and she was like, you know what? He's pretty hot. And then when she woke up in the morning and she fucking took a second look, she said, oh boy, ooh. She snuck out the window.
Could you imagine somebody being like, oh my God, Kurtwood Smith?
Like, I mean, besides his wife, sure. Well,
I know, but like this woman coming off the street, like, is that Kurtwood Smith? And he's like, hi.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's up, babe? What, you want to go back to my place or whatever?
I'm going like full, like Clint Howard there. I don't know. Like, Kurtwood Smith does not sound like that.
Kurtwood Smith kind of sounds
a little bit.
I don't know. It's hard to do, you know.
You're trying. I get it.
Whatever. I don't got a good Kurtwood Smith. What do you want from me?
I got a lot of bad accents. I shouldn't judge.
Yeah. So we get introduced to that character, yes. And then that's how we find out about the killings and all that stuff, and then we kind of tie that together from the beginning. It the way this is paced and the way that it's put together and the way the story is told is really, well, really well done. Like, I think so.
I mean, that's kind of what I was saying in the beginning. Like, I was making a big point about the ridiculousness of it, but just, yeah, everything really flows well together in this film.
As silly as it is, it doesn't take itself too seriously, but... whoever sat down and did the story structure gave a shit.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? But then we fucking bop over to the health food restaurant and we get Lin Shaye. Lin Shaye's back in the MDU, baby.
Yeah, after Critters 2, you know, first she was yelling about Brad Brown being back in town. Now she's yelling that she's on a personal call.
Now she's fucking serving up slop.
Oh my God. This looked like something out of fucking... body melt, you know, like that shit they're feeding people in that movie.
It's disgusting. It looks like the fucking Matrix food.
It looks like you just open up your fucking ass cheeks and let loose after some Taco Bell, honestly.
I don't know, dude. It fucking kills Bud Melman. He's at the fucking bar, and he's like munching on a fucking celery stick, and he fucking just dies on the counter.
It looks like, you know, refried beans that have gone through like 3 or 4 people before they put it on the plate.
Oh, yeah.
And I love the next shot because, you know, Denny's trying to make her order, and, you know, Lin Shaye's arguing with her because she's on the phone.
Yeah, Lin Shaye's like breaking up with her boyfriend.
Yeah, well, it's a personal call.
Yeah.
And then she's outside eating her burger. But you see Kaz is outside, like, in the garbage. And, you know, because he's sleeping there. Why not? It's warm.
In the background, you see Bud Melman get taken out on a fucking stretcher and nobody bats an eye.
The man's dead, clearly.
I'm here for that comedy. Yeah.
So then he kind of comes up to her and starts acquainting himself with her. And he's like, hey, you gonna eat that all?
Well, he's like, he's laying the guilt trip on her.
Yeah.
And she's like, you gonna finish that? She's like, yes. And he's like,
She's had one bite.
Yeah. She's like... And he's, you know, being a puppy dog fucking scumbag. He's mooching.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He wakes up, like, out of the trash, by the
way. That's what I'm saying. Oh, yeah.
There's, like, a couch covered in garbage, and he just, like, emerges from it.
It's like a cat.
It's a phoenix rising from the ashes.
Yeah, every night. So then she gives him the burger.
Fruit burger.
Yeah. Oh my God. This was hilarious. It's like it's a vegan burger, so it's all fruit and vegetables.
It's like beets and some other shit.
But the pisser is he bites into it and he's so upset he spits it all over his dress. And I'm like, all right, that's gross. But then they show it and I just about threw up myself.
I can't do spit or puke.
I mean, it's fake, but it was still disgusting.
No, I know, but like, you know what I mean?
I ate a fruit burger. You gave me a fruit burger!
And she's like, you see this red stain right here? That's beets! You see this yellow stain right here? It's some fruit I can never think of because it's a weird name.
These are sun-dried gooseberries or some shit.
And he's like, wait, I ate fruit? I ate a fruit burger?
Yeah, he's like,
fruit burger! And then he just won't leave her alone. And he's just following her like a puppy dog. She's like, yeah, you remind me of somebody. He's clearly inferring her dog that ran away from her.
Oh, yeah. What's the fucking dog's name?
Roscoe or something. Rocco.
Rocco. That's what it was. Because
there's a joke later in the movie where she's like, oh, well, we'll get to it.
Yeah. He's also like drinking Pepto-Bismol like on like behind her. I'm like, I don't. That's a little much.
Yeah, I mean, there's some sight gags, and again, there's a joke here or there that don't work, but most of them land.
No, but this one's fucking gold, dude. Yeah. Because he's like, well, let me buy you a new. What if I want to buy you a new dress or whatever? And he's clearly like, he looks like a fucking Red Skelton Huey Lewis, and like doing this fucking bump the tramp routine.
Yeah,
and she's like, oh, it's like $39.99 or whatever. And he's like, oh, you take a check? And he pulls out the fucking checkbook.
Yeah, that's when he does the joke. Well, yeah. What about American Express? And he pulls it up. What about a back card? I don't know. Maybe a back card, Joe? You think she would have taken that?
I don't know. Maybe to McDonald's.
Put it on fucking Bruce Wayne's, you know, bill. Fuck him.
He's never rich. Leave the Batcave without it, right?
That's what Cass said.
You think Cass stole Batman's credit card? Like Michael Keaton's Batman.
I mean, honestly, if you got
it
that,
didn't even come out yet.
If you got that close to Batman, he might as well have taken the damn suit and everything else while he was there. But hey, I mean, you never know. This is the MDU.
I don't know. Who he's like stalking doctors and like taking their checkbooks and their fucking credit cards.
I mean, he's a fucking hell of a pickpocket.
This is true.
At this point, too, like he wakes up in that trash because we see another scene before that at night where you see something stalking somebody.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So you get a little bit more insight into what's going on in terms of like what's happening to the girls, and they're getting killed and stuff. And they make you think that it's him.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's being a big fucking creep, and he's like following her home, and he ends up like tailing her, but like staying behind.
Yeah.
And then he's like across the street. He's like, oh, so that's where you live. And she's like, no, this is where my big giant boyfriend lives.
Yeah, that was creepy. I can't believe these two end up, you know, working out, honestly.
Don't do that.
No.
Don't do that to anybody.
Don't be that guy.
No,
or
don't,
gal.
Don't be that gal guy or anything in between doing that shit.
It's funny in a movie, but that was weird.
Well, he's like, oh, my stomach hurts. And she's like, oh, my God, what's wrong? And he's like, I think you need to, like, move me. And she, like, grabs him to pick him up. And she's like, I can't. He's like, get your big boyfriend. She's like, I lied. And then he kisses her on the fucking mouth and says, let's get married.
This is the point when she should have walked away.
And
she doesn't, but
no, something happens. He gets turned on because he starts to change.
Yes.
And then he runs away from her.
Yeah. So then we kind of cut it a little further into the day. And Chippy Boy's back, old boyfriend who stole all her crap.
Yeah, like you said, she comes back home and like fucking this Dennis Leary looking ass motherfucker's there. He does, man.
He's an asshole. He wipes his ass with the American flag, obviously.
He's sitting on the steps, like, waiting for her.
Well, he's inside. He's
that's right.
You're not supposed to get into unless you have the key.
Right, because there's, like, a fake out because you think, like, the mangler's going to grab her or something.
Yeah.
And she goes up into, like, the little apartment.
Yeah, like, the in-between.
The in-between, like, where your mailbox is or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
And he fucking comes up. He's like, oh, you fucking faked on me. He's like, I was picked up by the cops. And she's like, I didn't tell anybody anything. What are you talking about? And she's like, that, you know, I draw a fucking line at that. I'm going to kill you or whatever. And she runs away from him.
I mean, honestly, I feel like Sonya probably called the cops on him if anybody did.
Oh, big time. Well, he's a piece of fucking shit. Now, that's where it gets dark because it's like, all right, he was a fucking asshole and he did a lot of stuff. But now he's going to, like, physically hurt you. You know what I mean? Like, that's another dimension of this problem.
He's a character I kind of wish ate it, but he kind of just leaves the movie after this.
Or at least got his fucking ass whooped because Kaz jumps out of the fucking shadows.
Yes, and scare, like, the shit out of him.
Scares the shit out of him because Chip like pushes Denny down and she hits her head and passes out. But Kaz jumps out. He's like, hey, get away from her. And she just, he doesn't even say anything. The guy just runs away.
I mean, he has some kind of something going on with his face, some kind of transformation, but it's lit in a way where you can't really make the whole thing out.
You know that he's not human.
Yeah, but he brings her inside, which, again, creepy, but he did save her, so what else are you gonna do? Leave her out on the damn stone steps in the middle of Brooklyn?
Well, yeah, and like he makes her some coffee or whatever, and they're talking.
Oh, again, PSA to anybody that gets brought in by a stranger and handed a drink.
Don't drink the drink.
Don't drink it.
Don't drink the drink. You do, you don't, you do.
Yeah, just dump it out. Nice gesture, Kaz, but that was a flag there, Denny, that you should have fucking read.
Denny's not good at that.
She says she's not good at that.
She's not. Maybe you think she likes the abuse, maybe? She's like waiting for it. One point, she's like, I wish I would just die. And I'm like, that's sad.
I think she likes a little bit, maybe subconsciously, like in the back of her head, it's always like gnawing at her.
I guess. So she's on the she's on the couch and they're talking and
they become friends?
Yeah, because he's not being a creep. I mean, he is a creep, but he's not being a creep.
Yeah.
And they're just talking and, like, she like, breaks down. She's like, I'm a schlub.
Yeah, I'm a schlub. And he's like, you're not a schlub. She's like, I am.
I'm a total schlub. She's like, I brought you in. You fuck.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, well, yeah. You might be an idiot. I don't know about a schlub.
And then she's like, you know what? Since you helped me out, you could stay on my couch. And he's like, are you sure? I don't want to do it. Starts downpouring. He's like, and then it like cuts and he's on the couch, like with a blanket and a pillow.
It's this weird thing where like, he's like, what are you talking about? You could do whatever you want or like, you know, have whoever you want. And she's like, I'm a woman of the 80s and I can do this and that. And I can go have casual sex and all this stuff. Oh, she's like, but I don't. Call me old fashioned.
Yeah.
But I just want to take care of somebody and somebody to take care of me. And then she's just like, oh, yeah, yeah. I fall in love with bozos.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Chipping, you know.
I don't know if he's a bozo. He's a fucking criminal. Maniac. He's like a criminal rapist.
Well, yeah. So then.
Cass spends the night.
Yeah, well, he spends the night, but. He gets a little too excited, Joe. He sees her in her nightgown, and he, again, instead of just cranking that hog and rolling over, he's got to go out the window and on the prowl.
Well, he starts fucking turning. He's like, oh, and he's just fucking turning into a monster on the couch. So, he jumps out the window, out into the night.
Yes, and then, of course, another victim, which this was kind of like, I don't know if this meant into like black comedy a little bit, or if maybe just playing up the idea that Denny's not paying attention, but it's like on the radio while she's making him breakfast, and it's like very obviously the sister of her best friend. No reaction.
Even like I picked up on that. I was like, oh, that's the woman who owns the store. That's Sonya's sister. And she's like, want some toast?
Yeah, that she drops on the floor and then just like knocks off some fucking dust. I thought that was hilarious. And he's like, oh, no, I'm good. He didn't see her do that, but he's like, no, I'm going to get out of here. I got stuff to do. I got a fixer to talk to.
Well, not even, because this is the weird thing where she wants to like be with him already.
Well, again, 2 month like, relationship is a long term one in her eyes.
She like gives him breakfast. She's like, look, breakfast, burnt toast. Isn't it good? And here's some OJ. And he's like, oh, I got a weird taste in my mouth from last night. And like, I couldn't remember what I did. And she's like, what? And he's like, did we fuck? And she's like, no. And he's like, oh, okay, good. Well, by the way, I can't have sex with women. And she's like, are you gay? No, she doesn't say that. And he's like, no, I can't have sex at all. Because if I think about it or look at it, like, I can't do it. Yeah. Right. And she's like, it's okay. We could like still be friends with her. And he's like, just friends? And she's like, yeah. And then they have this fucking great montage together that I love so much.
Yeah, it's pretty great because it's like them just going around town, just hanging out.
It's just really sweet, like platonic stuff.
Yeah,
it's not like lovey-dovey shit. They're like having ice cream. They're playing the saxophone together in the park and
hanging out at the jungle gym.
Hanging in the jungle gym.
And then even we get that balloon motif comes back. She's got about 20 of these red balloons while they're like looking over the, I'm assuming the Hudson River. I mean, anybody from New York, correct me on that. I think it is though.
Probably. They're eating fucking hot dogs. It looked like the Upper West Side is what it looked like.
They play a joke up. At least I thought it was a joke, kind of referencing back to the burger when he houses it. When they got the two hot dogs, she starts housing his. Yeah, I thought that was funny.
The man fucking eats like because he writes checks and has credit cards, but never eats food.
Buy some damn clothes, Cass.
Buy some fucking food, man.
He buys a green t-shirt at some point or a long sleeve shirt. I was like, what? How'd you get that, Cass?
Oh, he gets new duds later. Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, we cut to the hospital after this montage.
Oh, Jesus, yeah. So they're all having, you know what it is? I think Denny's so in love with the fact that she has a new boyfriend or whatever. She totally just fucking
that
tunes out.
That is a thing, without a doubt.
Totally tunes out.
Yeah.
So then we cut, like you said, we were at the hospital.
We got Sonya there with her sister in bed and the lieutenant's there too.
And she goes in, and this is fucked up too. And it just dawned on me now, but like, this is like a pretty heavy scene for this movie, especially because, she's attacked by the mangler or whatever, but like, it has heavy, like, rape victim vibes. Which is basically what it is, because she's the only survivor so far, by the way, of these attacks.
And also her sister is kind of like...
She's like catatonic in the bed.
Well, yeah, but Sonya herself is kind of like playing the events back in her head, because she was with her, and you see it from like the POV of the monster, what was happening.
Oh, she grabs her like some kind, like she has some kind of fucking psychometry or something, or like link between the sisters or something, because like it's
I guess playing up that psychic, knowing the phone call is gonna, they don't really go heavy into it, but
Right. And but it's just enough there because you also get a little bit of that, like, because she owns the New Age store with her sister and stuff, so they do practice magic and or are have foresight or shit like that.
Yeah.
Or again, psychometry or mild variation thereof. It's pretty interesting and subtle and kind of cool.
Yeah, and then they kind of like go out because the sister kind of has, like you said, an episode, and they're trying to calm her down. Mm-hmm. And Sonya leaves, and Kurtwood Smith comes up, and he's like, "Yeah, so what do you think?
Am I getting late tonight or what? Are you fuck your sister?" She's like, "You haven't found the fucking mangler yet, and now it took my sister."
Yeah,
and he's like,
"Best I can, whatever."
Can you fly, Sonya?
Yeah,
I'd like to see you try, bitch. And then she storms off, and he's kind of just standing there like a dope, like trying to figure out what to do.
He's just inept the whole time, and that's like a...
Which is kind of the joke, I guess, no, right?
It's totally the joke, especially shit that happens later.
But then we kind of follow up on that that montage with Denny and Kaz, and they're kind of hanging out.
And he sees Fixer again. They're like out like shopping at night or some shit.
Yeah, well, while he's with Denny, you're right.
Yeah, so they're out together, and they're doing like they're like walking around and looking at stuff. And he goes over to Fixer, and he's like, "Get away from me! You cursed! You cursed boy!" And he's like, "What are you talking?" He's like, "You got to help me with this shit. Like, I got a problem because now I fell in love with this girl." And he's like, "Man, you stupid motherfucker." And he's like, you want to get rid of the curse? Like, what the fuck's wrong with you? And he's like, "Yeah, I got to get rid of it." And he's like, "All right." He's like, "All right, well,
you got the $20?
He's like, and he's like, "No." And he's like, "All right, come on around. Turn the fucking thing around." And he turned it around. And I love how
the suitcase that has the display.
The suitcase, yeah, because it's like that snake oil salesman kind of thing. And he opens this door, and instead this doorknob, this piece of door, and instead of a fucking crystal ball, it's like a crystal doorknob.
Yeah.
And he's like, "The crystal balls are getting expensive," or whatever. Good
and,
shit.
And literally, you have like a flashback sequence where he's like, "Let's see how you got this curse," and it's like this little like shimmer, and he says, "Hey, well, that's me as a kid.
That's me trying to fuck BB."
Yeah. He picked the wrong chick to hit on. Well, she hit on him. He just kind of rolled with it, and it was a major mistake because, you know, he's like maybe, what, 13 or 14?
BB. Oh, it's BB Shikaluso. I remember that day.
Yeah.
So he's making out with this chick on her couch, and her mom walks in, or grandma or whatever.
She grabs this guy and throws him on the couch and starts making out with him, and fucking Granny Van Damme walks in and is not having it, dude.
"Oh, you better not take off your clothes. You better put them back on.
What do you think you're doing, my granddaughter? Get out of here, boy. You know what's going to happen when I put the fucking Romanian hex on you."
Thinner.
He fucking touches his
and
thinner.
And for, again, the people that...
Pozassed.
Exactly.
Well, she shoots him in the fucking dick.
And for the uninitiated, GVD, Granny Van Damme.
Granny Van Damme. Go back to that Bleeders episode.
Oh, God. She is a staple on the show, much like John Hurt is. And again, go back. She's a horny grandma in a bathrobe in a wheelchair with a shotgun. That she just likes to fuck. I don't know. I don't blame her.
She's all over the MDU, by the way. She pops up many a time. We couldn't even count how many fucking episodes she's in, so... Just keep your ears and eyes out for that woman.
And if you hear that cackle in the sky...
You're fucked. Yeah. Literally. Oh,
yeah. She's going to get that wheelchair and just back you into a corner and just start pumping. Either with the shotgun or with the chair. And it really depends on what she's trying to get done that day.
So he doesn't get possessed. He gets pozassed.
Pozassed, yeah.
Because he's a fucking pozassed.
Exactly. And then he...
Romania, he's pozassed.
He can't fuck.
He can't fuck. He can't get his dick hard. Yeah. Well, he can get his dick hard, but it turns into a fucking, I don't know what, like Legend of the fucking Overfiend or something.
Sure. But he finds out through this dude that basically, if you're going to get rid of the curse, it's going to jump into the person that you're closest to.
Yeah.
But you basically have to do like a noble deed to even have a chance of it to get out of
you. Well, right. That's the caveat. You do the noble deed, you get rid of the demon, but the demon jumps into the person closest to you.
Yeah.
Now, Scott Valentine, or Kaz rather, takes this as like... Whoever he's intimate with, like, who is the closest person to him, like, intimately, right? Like, his girlfriend or whatever.
Which, I mean, I don't blame the guy based on what happens every time he gets a bad thought in his head.
No, he's got those Romanian blue balls, dude.
Straight Seriously.
Up, straight up.
And so, now that he has this information in pocket, he's not really sure what to do, because as much as he wants to get rid of it, he doesn't now want Denny to be, you know, cursed with this horrible affliction.
Yeah, but then it's just back and forth, so it can't go down that way.
All right. And this is where they do go back to the apartment.
Yeah, but this is the first of the messages that Charles keeps leaving Denny. Denny gives this fucking maniac her number, albeit she picked up a fucking bum off the street and has had him sleeping in her fucking house.
True. Yeah. This is a great bit. He's at the phone booth constantly calling Denny.
He's like, hey, Denny, I got tickets to this new show on Broadway where Sylvester Stallone's playing fucking
Hamlet.
Charles Dickens or some shit.
Yeah, oh my God. And then he calls again like a couple more times. At the last phone call, he's got like a fucking bouquet of roses. Like, he left and came back because she wasn't answering.
He just keeps calling incessantly. The guy's crazy.
They go back to the apartment and Denny's kind of like, you know what, let's take this up a notch. What do you think?
Well, because Kaz has her birthday for her.
Yes, especially after everything that had happened. Yeah. He sets it up. He's got a fucking nice little bow tie
on. Which is really sweet. Yeah. And like, he's setting up balloons and shit, and she like walks in on him and he's like, oh, happy birthday. And they have like fucking everything pizza. That pizza looked really good.
With candles on
it. Dude, it was sausage, peppers, onions, and olives. Like, that's my favorite pizza.
You want to just reach to the screen and grab some,
I really
right?
did, though. I really did.
And New York style, too, is good.
Oh, well, yeah. It's best pizza, really.
But yeah, you're right. And then that's when she's kind of starting to make the move on him and starts kissing him.
But she gives him he gives her the TV that was stolen by Chip.
That was great.
And it was funny.
She's like, oh, he's like, oh, do you love it? She's like, I always have.
It's a great bit. Why he did, but we never follow up with Chip, right?
Right.
Like, he should have went and kicked his ass. He's like, you took it from him? He's like, no, I paid for it with my fucking fake check.
Yeah.
Or his fake credit card or whatever.
I would have loved for him to kick his ass, but yeah, you don't get that.
Yeah, that pissed me off that he didn't get his comeuppance, but anyway.
So then they start making out, and Kaz, he knows something bad's about to happen, so he runs in the bathroom and turns the shower on, and she's like, the hell?
I kind of love it, because he's like, oh, cold shower. He's like, I can't have sex. And she's like, no, I get it, like, but it's okay. And he's like, no, you don't understand.
Yeah. She goes in there with him.
I love that she gets in the shower with him and he's like talking
fully
to
clothed.
Him. Yeah, both of them, and they're like talking to each other in the shower. I don't know. I thought I liked that shit.
And then we kind of see them dried off, and he's hemming and hawing if he's going to tell her what the hell the deal is. He's like, please, first of all, you got to believe me, and you can't get mad.
Yeah.
So he explains it. And like any normal person would react.
There's a great joke here, though.
Okay.
That I want to just
set
say,
me up.
Because this is my wife and I. Because we'll be talking, and I won't even realize I do it, but it's very exaggerated in this scene. But he like says it, you know, he does like the Klaatu Varada kind of thing about that he's a demon or whatever. She's like, what, you mumbling? He's like, I don't mumble.
And then he says it again. I'm a pozassed. I'm a pozassed. Yeah, and she just knows what that is.
Yeah.
And then she's like, I thought you were going to tell me something like real serious, and you come up with this crap. He's like, I told you not to get mad.
He's like, I can't fuck. I'm a demon. I'm going to turn into a demon. And she's like, get out of town. Why is that like a thing where she's like all pissed off at him?
I mean, it's a pretty ridiculous thing to tell somebody.
It is a pretty ridiculous thing. But like, wouldn't you be like, what is really going on? Like, you must have something really awful going on.
Without a doubt. Yeah. And she kind of does do that a little bit, but not to the extent I think that you're referring to, that most people would in reality.
Yeah, but she's ready to, like, kick him the fuck out or whatever, basically.
And
but
he's like,
oh, you want me to prove it? And he's like, put your mouth where my mouth is.
Yeah, and they start making out again. Yeah. And he starts, it takes him a hot minute, but he starts transforming into this, like, weird bald troll kind of thing. This fat troll.
Bingo.
Because he's got the hair. He's got this long, curly red hair. Yeah. And she grabs him on the head, and it like comes off like a fucking wig. And he's like, ooh.
She's playing with his ass.
Yeah.
And then his ass like expands.
Yeah.
And he's like this big fucking sloppy fat demon thing with these pointed ears.
It's pretty great.
He's like, he's like, see, I told you, bruh.
And she freaks the fuck out.
And she's like, get in the shower and cool off. And he's like, no, it doesn't work that way. I have to just like ride it out like a sun rash, she says. Yeah.
So then he goes backwards out the window again into the night.
He like laughs when he like jumps out the window. It's fucking funny.
But then like Denny, like, I guess feels bad that she was like so mean to him. and is just like the next day, just like wandering around town, like contemplating. Like, yeah, there's really no context. It's just a bunch of scenes of her walking around, and you just kind of have to read into it because she sees like other couples having fun.
Well, there's a couple layers here because before this, Sonia goes to the police station, and she's like, I saw the mangler.
Right.
She's like, She goes to Red or Clarence.
Yeah.
She goes to Clarence. She goes to Goldmember, and she's like, look.
Mr. Boddicker.
Yeah. And he's like, she's like, oh, I saw it. When my sister touched me, I saw the fucking demon or his face or whatever. And he's like, a fucking demon? He's like, are you serious? A demon? And she's like, look, I'm telling you, it's the we got to kill it with this magical sword or some shit. She's like, I'm going to bring him in. He's like, whatever. Go ahead. Go for it.
Right.
And
then
we get all these scenes of Denny like by herself.
Yeah, she's like, doo-doo-doo, just walking around town, seeing couples be happy. And I guess in the process, realizing, who gives a shit?
Well, not necessarily who gives a shit, but like Kaz just split and she didn't think he was coming back.
True. Which he does.
Yeah.
He does. And then he tries to like run out real quick when she comes home.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I'll see you later. And she's like, nah, hold on.
Well, that's with the red balloon and he's got the rose and he's trying to sneak out. So like there's also that motif too, which makes you think that he is possibly the mangler, even though he's got this because he has this weird thing where when he turns into the demon, he can't remember what happens. Kind of like a werewolf.
Well, right.
Even though he's conscious as the demon, he says that when he wakes up the next morning, he can't remember what he did.
Yeah, which, you know, obviously plays into the whole plot. So she wants to basically try to make it work. So they head back to their little local haunt at the bar. And they're hanging out there, and Sonya's there. I don't really understand this, but Sonya somehow gets hooked up with fucking Chuck?
Well, Sonya's at the bar, and she's trying to figure out who the mangler is. And for whatever reason, she feels bad for Chuck, because Chuck's like walking by, and he's like, hey, can I buy you a drink? And the lady just looks the other way. He's like, hey, can I buy you a drink? And then they look away. And then fucking he goes up to Sonya. He's like, hey, can I buy you? Oh, shit, it's you. Bye.
Yeah.
And she's like, wait a second, Chuck. Sit down. You can talk to me or whatever. You're striking out left and right. What the fuck's your problem, you fucking weirdo? And he's like telling her fuck his life story.
Oh, my. Okay. So this is my favorite part. Specifically because of the local humor here.
Oh, yeah, the Philly stuff?
Yes!
Yeah.
Oh, my God!
I was like, Jesus.
I only moved here like a year ago, but goddamn. Where it's like, you know, a lot of people say they're from Philadelphia, but I was actually born in the city. And
not in the suburbs.
Yeah, and what is he say? I wrote this down. I have to read this verbatim. And he follows up. He's like, yeah, you know, we may not have liked our teachers, but at least we didn't shoot them. I'm like, what the fuck?
It's so deadpan, too.
Yeah.
It's pretty funny.
And then we kind of cut over to Kaz and Denny enjoying themselves.
Yeah, well, they're kind of reconnecting and trying to figure out what the next step is for the relationship and what they're going to do. And then Sonya and Chuck come over. They're like at the bar. They sit down. They're like, oh, I'm finally going to meet Kaz. And Kaz is like, oh, he turns into the fucking the mask. He turns into a Tex Avery cartoon because her fucking tits are out. And he's like, ho, 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 ho.
She's like, ah, come on, Kaz. Get a hold of yourself.
He's like, wow, you're nice to meet you. Nice to meet you, tits.
Oh, my God.
What the fuck does he say? they sit down, and he's like, and they're like talking to each other, and Chuck is clearly like, oh, is that your boyfriend? And she's like, yeah, it's my boyfriend. He's like, oh, I've only been calling you for like 2 weeks, every day, every hour on the hour.
Yeah.
So then Kaz is getting all hot and bothered by Sony. He's like, oh, can I buy you a drink? Tits, my pleasure.
Oh, my God.
And his fucking eyes are, like, red.
Yeah.
And then, they end up leaving, and then Sonya thinks he's the mangler.
Right,
because
she sees that, but she's the only one that does.
And she's the only one who believes it, too.
But, yeah, they hit the road, and they go back to the apartment, but Sonya and Chuck, they go to the fucking the shop to get some weaponry.
Why does she take Chuck to the fucking New Age shop to get this sword?
I think because it's funny to have these characters interact, and also, again, plot.
Well, I do think it's funny, like, how we get everybody together to the last location, which we're going to talk about, but, like, there's no reason for her to, like, do that, except she needs him to go, like, tell the cops or whatever where they're going.
Yeah, and so he could be like, oh, wow, the dagger of Asmodeus of demon slaying? Oh, wow, yeah.
Impressive. And I'm like, how do you know what that is?
Yeah.
Well, she doesn't even bat a fucking eye.
There's a placard on the wall. That's how he knows what it is.
Well.
And she grabs this fucking, you know, ceremonial dagger, and she puts it in her pocket, and she's like, yeah, Chuck, you know, head down to here, and I'm going to go here, and, you know, meet me here at in 15 minutes. He's like, oh, okay, throws him the keys.
Because Sonia calls Denny and tells her to meet her at her place. So she wants her to leave.
Exactly.
Because she's going to go try to kill Kaz.
Exactly. And then this is where we get this fucking...
It's pretty smart, actually.
No, it is. But then we get this makeout session that results in Kaz turning into the demon. And then he's fucking this scene is insane.
Yeah, you're right. So what happens is, like, I guess nobody has ever fucked Cass or, like, went past him being, like, a demon, turning into a demon. Yeah. So, like, he gets hard, turns into the demon, and they're like, and they leave. This time, Denny's like, oh, you're a demon? Let's just do it. I'm going to suck that fucking demon, you know, put that demon seed inside me. And all of a sudden, the demon takes over and goes fucking insane. Then there's, like, water bottles blowing up, and the picture frames are fucking spinning around, and
all crosses are turning upside down.
All this crazy shit's happening, and the demon takes over, and... It's like a weird kind of like exorcist type deal. And it starts turning into different things. So first he goes full demon and he's like charging at
Bob Bull from fucking Punch Out.
Yeah. He's like charging at Denny into this fucking brick wall and his head gets like shoved into his shoulders.
You look turtle.
But it's bizarre because you're not expecting it, especially in this movie. And you're like, what the fuck?
I thought I was watching Drop Dead Fred for a third of a second there.
Oh, we got to do Drop Dead Fred. So he ends up like pulling his head out of his neck and it turns into this fucking like nerd guy. And Denny's like, what the fuck? And he's like, hey, Denny, you got any beers in the fridge or whatever? Got any cheese balls?
Yeah, we were trying to cheese balls.
And she's like, oh, no, the date that won't leave.
Oh, my God. It's great. And then
the
like,
lingerer.
Yeah. And then he walks out of the kitchen and now he's like her mother.
And she's like, it's her mother. And she's like, oh, you're never going to find anybody. And like, obviously, here you go. Projection of shit that happened as a kid and why she is the way she is. And then she goes and like goes to like attack him. She's like, stop it. And she puts her fucking fists through this guy's or through her mother's face into like peanut butter shit. It looks like when Steven Dorff crushes his dad's head in the gate and he got the ghoul over his hands.
Yeah. And it's like all the way down to the fucking elbow.
Oh, yeah.
And then like the mother is still talking out of the neck while shit's spurting out of it.
The fucking body's like in the corner with no fucking head and it's like spurting shit out. It's got like the whippy things like the in the thing.
That's what I was thinking of. Yeah. And then, like, you just hear, like, this little voice from inside the neck, like, hey, Denny, it's me, Kaz, I'm inside here! And she, like, gets real close and looks at it, and this fucking explosion goes off like Looney Tunes and blows her backwards, like, 10 feet into the couch.
It explodes, and then they get up, and she's fine, and Kaz is, like, back to normal, but he's wearing a dress. It's fucking insane.
And then she gets a call from Sonia. Gets it from Chuck, actually. He's like, well, you finally picked up!
Oh, right.
And he's like, yes. It is from Sonia. I'm sorry.
No, yeah. Because Sonia's like, oh, you can come meet me. I need to do something. So she leaves.
Yeah.
And then Sonia sneaks in the fucking
the
fire escape to kill Kaz.
With the knife, yeah.
With the dagger, the Asmodeus dagger. And he immediately has a fucking boner for this woman. He sees her boobs. He's like, oh, shit. And then he turns into like a fucking caveman with wings. Anyway, so this is where you find out Chuck is the fucking mangler because his hand fucking transforms and grabs Denny and he like captures her.
And he has a red coat that kind of looks similar when he's running as Kaz's blazer.
Are you sure?
100%. He's got a red jacket on. It looks exactly like the blazer from behind.
Oh, kind
of,
yeah.
That's why they keep showing shots of this demon thing going after people with this red jacket.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. Okay, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
But yeah, he does take Denny. But like, Kaz sees this happening from like the third story, and he jumps off the fire escape like fucking Superman and grabs onto the top of the car as it's fucking driving.
He grabs onto
off.
It. He fucking slams on top. And Chuck's like, what the fuck? The way that they get these characters to the finale of the film is pretty fucking great.
I mean, Sonia gets on the fucking hood of the car.
So Denny's passed the fuck out in the passenger seat. Chuck is driving.
Sonia's car, by the way.
Kaz is jumped onto the hood of the car and is holding onto it. And now Sonia jumps out onto the car and holds onto the front of it. So Chuck is driving this fucking car to the end game. And everybody's like hanging on for dear life and like having like, you know, you know, like comedy bits in between.
Yeah, oh, yeah. The comedy version of what was that Tarantino movie on Grindhouse?
Oh, Death Proof.
Yeah, like the comedy version of Death Proof.
Kind of.
Like, whoa! And then like a cop comes up to him because obviously.
Okay, so it was like how do we get Fixer to the fucking endgame?
Yeah.
And the cop has Fixer like in the back, and he picked him up. He's like, yeah, your possession of bolt, whatever, whatever. He's in the car, and then that cop sees them driving on the fucking car. It's pretty fucking brilliant to get everybody to the end place.
Yeah, and then like even though he sees people on top of a vehicle, he sideswipes the car. I'm like, pull over. It's like, what?
They're having conversations between each other in the cars. It's pretty funny.
And then like just basically they somehow end up in Central Park.
No, I think they end up at Belvedere Castle. I think that's what that is.
Oh, is that what that's supposed to be?
Well, it's a castle, first of all, and I was looking it up, and I was like, I was looking up shooting locations. It doesn't say it explicitly, but I'm pretty sure it's Belvedere Castle in New York.
Okay. Because they crash into a fucking lake.
And, in like a pond, yeah.
Yeah, Sonya's car's fucked. And then, much like Guyver 2, they're having a fight in this water, Sonya and Kaz, while Denny's getting trotted off by Chuck.
Yeah, she stabs him with the fucking thing in the arm, and she's like, you didn't die. And he's like, no shit, and that really hurt.
And then he's like, no, it's Chuck. And she's like, oh. Yeah, that makes sense.
Makes sense.
Yeah. But yeah, they chase them to this castle, and the cops all kind of get there. And, you know, constantly Chuck, he's like, I got a bomb. He's got this dynamite and he's like rubbing it all over Denny. It's like all sexual. He's like, what the hell?
He's so fucking weird, man, because we like get a better glimpse into like who he is. And he has like a secret lab and shit.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was
and
weird.
And he's like, look, this is my Bible. And it like I need new binding. And this is my table. And this is my lab.
Here's my friend Harry. He grabs a dead rat and makes a kisser. It's like, oh, my God.
I can't wait to meet your parents or whatever he says. And she's like, who are you? And he's like, I'm the mangler, dummy.
And she's like, oh, okay.
Makes sense.
But all the cops get there, including Kurtwood Smith. And they're like, okay, well, you know, okay, another character that gets introduced late into the film, which is a hilarious little detail, is this sniper.
Oh, yeah.
This like playing up the
he's
joke.
He's like, you think you could take him out? And he's like, yeah, sure.
And, you know, really making fun of, like, you know, SWAT people.
Inept cops, basically.
Yeah, because he's like trying to get up to a tree to get a good, you know, sniping position. He keeps fucking falling and breaking his ass.
He can't climb the tree.
But we have this hilarious effing scene where they can't get into the castle.
Well, Sonya comes up with the plan that Kaz could just go around the back because he's a fucking demon. And he's like, I can't just do that.
Yeah. And she's like, well, what do you need? He's like, I need to be aroused. She's like, sex? Yeah. And she's like, oh, honey, I can take care of that. And starts lip locking with him.
I'm the fucking expert.
Oh,
and those
my
fucking
God.
Buzzies just start bouncing and she's fucking tongue kissing this guy. They're fucking in a field. They're literally rolling
around. Save his girlfriend.
They're literally rolling around in a field and he's feeling her tits up and she's fucking dry humping his dick.
Yeah, I mean, you don't see anything, but it's a lot of implied shit. And there's this hilarious line because Denny sees this happening in the cornfield.
Yeah.
And she's like, and that was supposed to be my best friend. And then like you just said, they're literally fucking, like, she's on top of him, riding him, going up and down.
Where is the poltergeist for this?
I mean, it's getting shot inside her vagina.
Oh my God, it's exorcising the demon.
I mean, hey, again, that Cupid, let's leave it at that.
It's possible.
I don't think it's funfetti coming out of that guy, maybe molten lava.
No, he fully ejaculates.
He's got a cigarette, so I think that's the implication. Even though she never actually takes her pants off on camera.
No, it was the over the pants hand job kind of thing, but with her vagina.
That's what he told Denny, just to kind of like smooth it over a little bit. But yeah, that was raw dog as hell.
Oh yeah, dude.
And meanwhile, you got Kurtwood Smith, who's been trying to get in her pants the whole movie. He's like,
he's just staring at her like, oh shit. And this cop next to him's like, yeah, get it, you demon.
Which is something I would expect out of, like, you know, Knocked Up or something, you know, something about Mary. But it, being in this film, I had to pause. I was laughing so hard. I couldn't breathe. I was like, talk about the definition of friend zoned. And she's not even his friend. Just watching this. He is cucked. He's literally cucked.
Straight
watching
up.
Watching a demon.
Straight up.
Go to town. Boom. Feeling that, you know, going to, you know, up and down. That is some rough shit. In fact, she was getting some rough shit.
She was.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, maybe that was the whole thing. She wasn't getting him from fucking a Janice there. Or Phil Janice, whatever the fuck is. Kurtwood Smith.
And the little cherry on top of this whole scene is right after they're done with, he's done smoking a cigarette.
Oh, man.
She's like, okay, let's do it. Let's go.
I feel fan-fucking-tastic. And then he grows his wings and flies off.
This is the greatest because it's like a miniature and it just flies off into the fucking night.
But it looks great.
No, it looks awesome.
And she's like, go get him! As it drips down her leg.
Oh my God. She's just got a huge stain on the front of her.
I mean, she hasn't had a chance to grab a towel or to go sit on a toilet, so it's just going to be in there dripping.
I mean, I guess so.
I mean, that's how it works if you're not aware. Anyway, so he gets up there and you think he's going to save the day, right, Joe?
Oh, yeah. And it's funny as hell because he goes up there and...
Oh, wait. Real quick. One quick scene I don't want to forget before we get into this final confrontation. So the knife doesn't work on him. So before, you know, him and Sonya go off in the field, she throws it to the side. And there's this hilarious visual of the fixer picking it up and just slowly, like, putting it in his jacket. And I'm like, is he stealing that? We find out later that he isn't, but it's just a hilarious shot.
I thought that he needed to stab Kaz with
right.
it. That's what I thought. Anyway.
But yeah, so then we get to this climax where now the cops are going in and Kaz is up there in full demon form.
Oh, it's great. And they're running around the whole fucking thing. And like Chuck is like, I can't wait to meet your parents. And like, when we're going to go out on our first date or whatever. And Kaz is up on the fucking roof, full demon. And the fucking sniper you were talking about before is like looking at him through the scope because he goes to shoot Chuck. And he's like, oh my God, there's a pozassed up there. And he jumps out of the tree.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Chuck's got this fucking dynamite and Kaz takes it from him.
I forgot this. Oh, this killed me too.
I was laughing so fucking hard because...
I'm telling you, this is an underrated comedy classic.
Oh, it's great. It's great.
I mean, it's not the best, but it's like, there's just so many great scenes.
It's a ton of fun. So he's got the dynamite and Sony's like, throw it in the water. And he's like, oh, and he throws it, but he throws it at a fucking cop car and it explodes all the fucking cars. And Fixer's like, ha ha.
He like overshoots it, like goes over the lake and blows up like six cop cars. And all the cops are like, okay. Yeah, the Fixer cracks up.
Oh, yeah.
I was dying. I was like, well, they kind of deserved it. And he's just like, oh, shit.
And then
Chuck transforms.
Yeah, so we finally find out that he's also a demon. And Kaz like, goes after him, and he starts laughing at him. And then he has, like, this fucking Superman breath that, like, blows him up the roof.
Whoa.
Yeah. And apparently he's a pozassed too, but like an even more powerful one because he can like shoot shit out of his fingers and stuff. See, that's the thing. Like he's like
going full Palpatine.
Well, yeah, but he like honed his skills.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Like as a demon. And he can also change at will unless he can make his dick hard at will. I don't know.
Based on the way this episode's been going, he probably can.
So Kaz goes after him and he transforms fully. And he's like, I wish BB was here because he zaps him and he's turning back into regular Kaz. So he's trying to get hard again or like horny again. So Sonya's screaming at him. She's like, look at my breasts. And she's like, I'm not wearing any underwear.
Yeah. Oh my God. That was, well, clearly he knew that already.
Well, this is also true, but he's like, I wish BB was here. And he's like, oh, BB, she was great. But a grandmother sucked.
Yeah, oh,
and you
great.
Find out that like he's a pozassed because of the fucking grandmother too.
Yeah, that was funny.
Yeah, I thought it was funny.
And then meanwhile, Denny's just trying to crawl the fuck away.
Oh, dude.
On this like ledge out of like Batman 89.
Before we get too far off this, the way that fucking Charles transforms is like he sticks his thumb in his mouth and starts blowing and his fucking head gets bigger and bigger and bigger and then he explodes into the demon. It's really fucking
That's
cool.
Some Judge Doom shit.
Oh yeah. Well, I was thinking of Judge Doom too.
Do you remember me, Kaz? When I killed your brother?
Surprise? Oh, we're French kissing. I'm not having any, I don't have any underwear on. And he still can't get it up, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So Denny gets away and it's like the final battle, whatever, but Kaz is just himself. He's not the demon.
Yeah.
So this is when Fixer, like, throws him the fucking Odious,
Asmodeus knife.
And he's like, stab him in the skull! And his just happens to be on his chest, so he fucking stabs him right in the chest with it. And then he's like, oh, you stabbed me, son of a bitch! And he, like, throws him across the way, and they grab him. And if you notice here, Fixer's like, oh, I got him! Stand back, everybody! I got him!
Oh, yeah.
So he's like, you did it. You did something noble. You killed the other fucking demon.
And he's healed, as we find out.
Yeah, well, because he talks to Denny, and there's like a big like fucking burst of light, and he's transformed into fucking Beetlejuice's wedding outfit.
Yeah, he gets like a nice tuxedo.
Yeah, the Beetlejuice tuxedo. Yeah. It's fucking like maroon with the ruffles and shit.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. And they walk off. Off to a life of happiness, possibly.
Yeah, it's really cool too, because when the Chuck demon explodes, there's like really good composited like lighting effects, like all the hand done lighting effects and stuff. And like when he pulls the knife out, it's like this oozing fucking hole of like lava blood shit that comes out. That's really neat.
Yeah.
But yeah, they go off into the night, and he's like, "I'm cured. This is great." And he's like, "Wait a second. Fixer told me that if I got rid of the demon, it was going to pass into the person that's close to me." And she's like, "Oh, you mean like right next to you?" And he's like, no, not right next to me, somebody that I love." And he's like, "You sure?" And then they kiss, and he grabs her boob to like turn her on, question mark. And he's like, "You're fine." And she's like, "Okay, we can be together now."
Well, then they rush home to have hardcore sex probably all night, to be perfectly straight.
This is true. But before
they have that look in their eye, that little twinkle in the eye, like, "Oh, it's going down tonight."
We cut back to Fixer, and like he grows these terrible fucking like CG, like rudimentary CG horns that composited out of his head. And he's like, "Oh, I'm loyal." What the fuck is that? Well, hey, baby, let's howl.
Yeah, because there's this female officer that they show one other scene previously chasing Kaz around because he's being a pervert, and it's the same woman.
It's fucking great.
And she's giving him a hard time, and he starts chasing her, like running at her with these red eyes, smiling.
He cannot wait to turn into a demon with like four dicks that are spiked and just go to town on this woman.
He got an additional three? Kaz got stuck with the one. This man gets four.
How do you know?
Well, this is trying to pull down his pants and check. One, two.
One for each hole. There you go.
Oh, there you go.
So Fixer's now a demon.
As he always wanted.
And cue that fucking Intimate Strangers, dude, because we go back to Denny's and we order that fucking Grand Slam, baby, because they are fucking, they pull down the shade and they're fucking inserting. And happy birthday, Denny.
Happy birthday indeed.
Mm. They got that funfetti cake, dude. It turned out.
And she finally got it.
She finally got it.
She didn't even need a cherub. She had Denny all along.
There you go.
She had Kaz all along. She had herself. She had Denny from Scream Blackula Scream. She came in, Willis's girlfriend. Weirdly enough, we didn't mention it till literally now, but back-to-back movies with characters named Denny. That doesn't happen too often.
Bizarre. Denny, of all things.
Mm. Was popular in the 70s and 80s, I guess.
I guess so. So they're fucking and sucking all night. And then I love this because we do the character montage.
Yeah.
I love this stuff.
80s staple.
I know, but I love it, and I kind of wish they'd bring it back because it's, I don't know, it's fun.
We also get a couple different camera angles, which are fun to see.
Yeah, like the different takes of them, or if it's like an outtake or whatever, and it says their name and stuff and who they played. It's cool.
Yeah. And then credits.
And that was it. That's all she wrote. I love this movie so much. But with that being said.
Yeah, I mean.
Where are we putting this?
This is definitely a shelf movie. And if you don't know what that means, it means we liked it. It's good. It's going on the damn shelf with all these other movies behind us.
Oh, yeah. By the way, second episode. We didn't explain this last time to all you new viewers.
Yeah.
That's our rating system. Is it in the dumpster or is it on the shelf?
And sometimes there's an in-between, but that's
sometimes
that's
there's
the
an
general.
In-between, but that's the general. and there's varying degrees of each.
But yeah, absolutely in the shelf. Like I said, not the best comedy I've ever seen, but when you know, the way it's put together, there's like a laugh a minute. There's very few jokes that I'm like sitting there saying, all right, that didn't work.
Yeah.
And again, it's one of the effing weirdest movies ever seen. In a good way.
I love how you said effing, but you've been talking about cum and dicks and
people's mouths.
I know,
it's just, you know, in the back of my head, you know, whatever word comes to mind at
the YouTube
moment.
Algorithm.
Yeah, at an hour and change into the fucking review.
I didn't mean to derail you.
No, you're good, you're good. There's just a lot to like. The acting's really good, especially for a lot of people, at least in 2022, that are no names. You know, Scott Valentine's in fucking Carnosaur 3. Does that even mean anything?
Well, he was on Family Ties at the time, or before, or a little bit before that.
Yeah, but...
Which was a big show.
Sure, and I read, like, Michele Little has, like, retired from acting since then, and I didn't really go deep beyond that.
Yeah.
But with that said, like, yeah, the effects are amazing. I mean, you went down the list of people involved, and I'm sure you even left a couple names out.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
And it was just a really pleasant surprise, and I just sit here, like, I know you probably think about this a little more than I do, but I was just sitting there thinking, man, if you were in the theater seeing this when this came out, like, how more relatable this would have been.
Probably.
But sitting here, you know, 40 years later, which hurts me to even say.
I am not 40.
No, I'm saying since it came out.
Yeah, this movie came out in 1987.
Oh, I thought it was earlier. It's 34 years old.
Sorry. Jesus Christ, this fucking guy's trying to put me in an early grave.
Joe's Dorian Gray painting upstairs just melted. But I guess my point is, you know, it holds up really well. And if you haven't seen this, it might be a little hard to... Again, it is. You can rent it if you want. And maybe that DVD if you want to spend a little bread.
I'm sorry, I don't have any bread with me.
I highly recommend this one. And if you can find it, definitely check it out. Pleasant surprise. Probably one of the funniest movies I've seen in a long time, to be really honest with you.
Dude, shelf for sure. I mean, it was on the shelf. Anyway.
That's where you got it.
It was right there, but now it's up there and it's not here where it should be for the episode. But anyway, yeah, it's just, I've been thinking about this movie a lot, and it was the perfect time to pull the trigger on this. And it was just one of those things where it was like, it's got great special effects. It's got great writing. It's shot really well. Like Sean said, it's just super fucking funny. And it really works. Everything about it shouldn't work, but everything does. And that's when you get that fucking like lightning in a bottle kind of stuff. You know, is it the best comedy ever? No, not by a long shot. But it's super fucking enjoyable, and it's got that 80s fucking stink all over it that I love, and it exudes it, you know, with your fucking dime store Tears for Fears band.
Yeah.
Doing all the music in this. Again, the effects are just like top notch, like, and it's so fun the way that they're implemented, because it's never like egregious in a way where we're doing it just to do it.
Yeah.
Like, it's very strategized how they unfold in the film, you know what I mean? And that apartment scene where his fucking head goes into his shoulders and his head blows off and the fucking get punched in, like, it that's worth price of admission alone. It's just a ton of fun, and it is truly, you know what it is? It's truly one of those movies, like, is why we do this show.
I was literally, as you're talking, I didn't want to interrupt, because I know how that is when you're giving your final thought.
Yeah.
You know, there's just so many movies that we've covered that fit that, but yeah, you're right. This one immediately comes to mind of like, how do more people have not know about this, you know?
This is one of those hidden gems that we always try to dig out for you, because I know that a majority of people haven't seen this. Again, there's going to be folks that have seen this movie or at least heard of it, especially in the circle, or if you're into low-budget movies or B-movies or 80s movies, whatever. But I think this slips under a lot of people's radar. And again, it's put out by New Line Cinema too, which was strange to me that it hasn't got a proper like release or Blu-ray or whatever. Because I think there's only that DVD copy and it's out of print, I think. Mm-hmm.
Which is a shame, because I would love to buy a Blu-ray copy today.
I think it deserves it. So it would be cool for them to release it, or if, again, like a Vinegar Syndrome or a Severn or something put it out. I mean, they release some stuff that I'm surprised that they put out before other things, and it's usually like really, really obscure shit. This isn't that obscure in terms of those kinds of movies, but the majority of people haven't seen it. And again, like I said, you know, I was very excited to bring it to the table, not only for you to see it, but to show every, you know, the audience that hasn't experienced it. But again, like, get your hands on it if you haven't seen it, for sure. If you're a fan of 80s comedies, any 80s rom-coms with fucking monster shit in it, you can't beat it. You can't beat it. It has a little something for everybody in this.
The social commentary alone is worth, like, you know, you said it already, but price of admission.
Oh, no. Yeah, the social commentary on this is insane, especially, like, dealing with so many different levels of things, from relationships to
authority,
self-image, authority, the rape stigma, all that kind of thing.
Like, topics that would be heavy in any other film, but they make, like, they don't make light of these heavy subjects, but they treat them in a way that is effective in for the film.
Satirical.
Yes.
And exactly. Satirical doesn't necessarily mean that they're being made fun of in a way to negate them.
No.
It's a way to talk about them in a, you know.
I mean, they're making fun of the whole idea.
You should know what the fuck satire is.
Yeah, yeah, but it's that, you know, just on the base level, Denny situation that she just... Someone that falls for all the wrong people and falls in love a little too fast. And, you know, I'm sure everyone at home knows someone, or maybe is possibly that person. So it's just funny to really just, you know, satirize, like you're saying, that concept, and then all these other concepts throughout the film. And it's just really effective.
Oh, 100%. This might be a stretch, but it's like listening to Elliott Smith, right?
Okay.
Because it's incredibly sad, depressing music, but presented in a happy way.
I could see that.
Do you see what I'm saying? Yeah. In my opinion.
It brings me back to my high school days of listening to a lot of emo music.
It was tight question mark.
I don't know. I was just trying to relate, Joe. Don't assassinate me.
I'm not assassinating you. I'm saying, like, it does it with a laugh in the movie, but they are serious things.
That emo and music was not doing it with a laugh. No. Sure, it was not.
It's just a weird, it's just all around fucking weird. Scott Valentine is like insane in this movie, and his performance is fucking great. And everybody's comedic timing is on point. Even Sonya, too, I think is very funny.
Again, like, she gets fucked by a demon, and her first thing after that is like, go get him, pal! Like, oh my, like, what? It's just weird. It's wacky.
The guy who plays Chuck is funny as hell, and he plays his role, like, perfectly. It's a great time. It's just a really fun time, and especially, and again, it's on Amazon, fire it up. I think it's like $2, because it's like SD.
Oh, maybe. Maybe it's even cheaper than I thought.
Yeah, or $3 or some shit like that. Like, and it's
cup of coffee!
And it's prime time to watch this film, especially during the holiday. You got your girlfriend or your boyfriend or your whatevers, significant others or whatevers.
Your dog, maybe.
Your dog, your cat.
Rocco.
That's
that was
right.
The joke.
Rocco the dog.
We'll get back to that later. And then I forgot she lets him sleep on the couch. And she's like, you remind me of Rocco.
And he's like, who? Yeah. She's like, never mind.
So we got it in there.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Fire it up, especially now. Find it and check it out. You won't be disappointed. And if you are disappointed, maybe there's something wrong with you.
Yeah.
You know?
And,
I'm just kidding.
Well, I'm not.
Check it out for yourself and see if you like it. You know how that goes with our show.
Absolutely. Yeah. Some other Valentine's Day content we have coming.
Oh, man. We got a smorgasbord.
We have that book to the movie.
We got a box of chocolates.
Yeah. Yeah. So we actually know what's in it, though. We know what we're going to get.
Oh, yeah. You fucking took a bite of all of them.
That's
coconut and that's caramel.
I mean, it's kind of a layered joke on some level because, like, we don't know what we're going to get, but we also know what we're going to get because we don't know what Smith's going to say about the book, but, like, we know what's in the movie. Again, it's an onion.
So this is, like, your two-parter, right? Your two-part Valentine's Day event.
Double feature.
Double feature, if you will.
Even though they're separated by several days.
Well, yeah. But it's leading into one another.
Yes. And then after that, at the end of the month, we have some more things coming. We got that Blackenstein watch along for patrons over patreon.com/moviedumpster for 5 and 10 tiers. And
you can net yourself, if you're on that 5 or 10, not only do you get the commentary tracks and watch alongs and that Blackenstein watch along, but you get a sticker pack and a air freshener for 5. But if you go for 10, you get a fucking enamel pin that glows in the dark, a t-shirt, a sticker pack, and that air freshener. Yep. So you get a little some extra perks, and you're supporting the show.
Yes.
And you're getting the live watch alongs and the commentary tracks and the minisodes.
Yeah,
and the junk mails that we didn't mention on the last episode.
That's true. Junk.
Send us your junk.
Junk mails. We have one that's coming out at some point. We recorded.
It should be out
now. It might even be out
by the time this drops. It'll definitely be
okay,
out.
It'll be way
out.
We'll have that, and that's on the $2 tier and above, along with minisodes. And we got one coming. You may have heard about it by now.
That's right. Let's break that. We didn't talk about that last time. But for the $2 tier on Patreon, you get the minisodes and you get the junk mails.
Yes, and
not bad.
No, you know? Not at all. Less than a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
It was like a mozzarella stick, maybe. I mean, you don't get some marinara with it, but you get the stick.
A month, though.
Yes.
It's $2 a month,
yes.
Not a week or a day.
Exactly.
Know? You'll never miss it.
No. And all the old stuff's always there, so come on in and you'll have plenty to play with.
Well, that's 2, 5, or 10. You get access to the back catalog of whatever's open to you on each of those tiers, too. So don't forget that. There's a wealth of content that's already up for you to jump right into.
And as always, if you could do us a favor, head over to wherever you listen to this or watched it. Give us a like, maybe subscribe, write a review if you got time, because it does really help the show out. And get more people to listen to it. We got to get some more dumpster dwellers in here.
Yeah, please.
You know, it's getting full, but it's... you know, the dumpster gets bigger every day, every month, every year. It's growing.
It's like the TARDIS. It doesn't look too big from the outside, but inside it's gigantic. Yeah, there's a whole universe in here. The galaxy's on Orion's belt, or in this case, in the dumpster, okay?
It's on John Hurt's belt, I think.
This is true. Another notch in his belt, that's for sure, in this universe. And please, before you jump out of here, hit that like button down there and subscribe. And again, if you subscribe, you'll know when these videos are coming out, and we don't even have to tell you. It'll just pop up on your phone, and so you can hit the premiere if that's something you like to do, or watch it later. And like Sean said, if you go leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcast, that's awesome too, because there's also an audio version of this show for those of you cats who like to listen to podcasts instead of watch videos, right? And Spotify has implemented their new rating system, so definitely go over to, if you're a Spotify listener, hit that 5-star on there, would you? Or Stitcher too, wherever you can rate the show, do us a favor and just hit it. It's right there. It takes 2 seconds.
And just one last thing. I don't know if I have to say this, or I feel like maybe I should say it. If this is like your first episode, we have like 4 years of audio content out there. It's on YouTube. It's on all the podcast platforms that Joe just listed. So check it out.
Yeah. There's 4 years worth of content, both bonus and public.
Yes.
But this is, again, our second foray into the video world. So we're very excited to keep going with this. And we hope you're enjoying the show. And
the only thing I would say is watch out for that cherub. I mean, it tastes very good, but, you know, not everybody's into that.
You might have a sore throat at the end of the night, but I mean, is it worth it? Maybe. Maybe. So that's it. That's My Demon Lover from 1987, directed by Charlie Loventhal. I'm Joel Escola.
And I'm Sean O'Rourke.
Thanks for visiting the dumpster.